word of God. Let's look at Acts chapter 4, verse 33. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Sophia, if you can, when we do the tithes and offerings, instead of those hands, if you can maybe cue up some of those old tithing testimonies for me, amen, and we can get that going, but it's going to be later in the service. The Bible says in Acts 4:33, the Bible says, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked, for as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold and laid them down at the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. Father, bless the reading, the hearing, and the proclamation of your most holy word. And bless your people, Philadelphia. Give us wisdom, God. Help us to know what we're doing before we do it, God. Help us, God, with wisdom, O King. Help us with, give us wisdom. And bless us, O God, with a word that'll shake us, that'll chase those who are not really with us out of here, Lord God. That'll confirm those who really committed to us, God, and to you. We pray that you do it by your grace and for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Come on, give God some glory, amen. All right. Okay, listen. I'm going to tell you straight off the bat, all right? We're going to be trying to get some people out of here this morning, all right? So, buckle your seatbelt. Come on, you know how we do it. Buckle your seatbelt. All right? Because we're going to be trying to get you out of here. If you're not, we're just going to shake the tree. And anything that ain't really grafted in or connected, it should fall off after today. All right? And so after this message and after people leave, don't come tell me, oh, everybody leaving. That was the plan. All right? Don't come talk about who leaving. All right, we're trying to cut off what's dead so we can make space for what's alive. Amen? All right? All right. It's been a while since I wore a bow tie, but I just felt like it in this morning, you see. It seemed like Brian felt the same way. So it was confirmation. Listen, I done forgot about the announcements. This week is a regular week. Prayer, Monday through Friday, Thursday prayer. Amen. Nursing home ministry today at 1:45 at River Oaks. Amen. And hallelujah. Golf tournament was wonderful yesterday. Boy, we had a wonderful time at the golf tournament. It was amazing. Philly is clicking on all cylinders. The golf tournament was a hit. Even our hunting ministry bringing meat back, Brother Duck and Brother Joe. Amen. Everybody blessed right now. Amen. And you got to get in on the blessings. Any other announcements, love? All right. So last time we were here, we were in Acts, amen, chapter 4. And we had 5 points last time. We talked about the effects of a praying church. And the 5 points were as follows. We talked about God's presence. Amen. We talked about the filling of the Holy Ghost. We talked about boldness. Amen. We talked about unity. Amen. And then we talked about generosity. We want to pick up in verse 33. And the title of the message is going to be just a continuation of this idea of generosity. We're going to look at generosity because this is where the scripture is. And so we're just going to stay on it. It's where the Bible is. It had not been my plan to talk about generosity. One of the brothers told me that, hallelujah, it was a year since I taught about finances, amen, or giving in any type of way. This is not a money church, amen. We preach the word in an expositive fashion, but when it comes up in the word, we're not going to run from it now. We're not going to run from it. Amen. To those who may be visitors here, amen. I wish you would have come. One brother said, Pastor, I'm coming this weekend. I said, don't come this weekend, my brother. I'm going to bring my wife, my girl. I said, my brother, I said, it's not the weekend. I told him, I said, come next weekend, but it might not be. Let's go. We're going to talk about 3 points this morning. Number one, great grace. Somebody say, great grace. Number two, possessors of lands. And number three, at the apostles' feet. Good job. Let's begin with our first point, great grace. And the Bible says, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. I love what this verse says in verse 33. It says, with great power. Somebody say power. Amen. Power was upon the apostles, the early church. And remember where power comes from. Amen. Power comes from God because it belongs to God. But he sends us power when we pray. Amen. Like what the old folks say, they say much prayer equals what? Much power. So great power was on the early church. Power to heal. Power to cast out devils. Power in preaching. Amen. Signs, wonders, miracles. Amen. All of this power came from God, and the power was activated with prayer. If you want power, the answer is prayer. God bless you and God bless the truth. Amen. But the Bible says that they not only operated in power, with great power gave the apostles witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, but they also had a great something else. They had great grace. Great grace. The Bible says great grace was upon them. Now, grace right here is the Greek word charis. It means favor. It means backing, when somebody has your back. It means when somebody is looking out for you, looking out for your benefit. Favor means somebody respects you. They support you. They bless you when they have an opportunity. Favor and grace means that they have a natural bias towards you, an inclination towards you. Amen. Grace and favor means that they want to cooperate with you. They're friendly towards you. It's a kindness and it's a goodwill towards you, amen, that you don't deserve. That's what grace is. That's what favor is. And the Bible tells us there's two types of favor. There's favor with God, and then there's favor with man. The scripture right here is telling us that the early church had both. They had favor with God, and they had favor with man. They had favor with God. God was backing them, looking out for them, respecting them, supporting them, blessing them, biased towards them, cooperating with them, showing them goodwill and kindness that they did not deserve. But they not only had favor with God, they had the same favor with man. Men were now backing them, showing them favor and kindness and goodwill, looking out for them, supporting them. You see, both God and man were looking out for their benefit. You ever met somebody with favor before? Somebody who had grace before? Favor with both God and man? And it seemed like, amen, they shouldn't have it and don't deserve it. And things end up working out for them that shouldn't work out for them. All right? They at the right place at the right time. They get the job, amen, that they shouldn't get or that nobody else could get. They get the wife that everybody wants. Hey! They get that husband that everybody trying to get. They get the house and the numbers don't line up. They get that ministry position while everybody thought that they wasn't worthy of it. They get that promotion. They get the healing. They get the financial blessing. They always get the calm. They always get the things that they don't deserve. People like them, favor them, put them up. Amen. It just don't seem fair. But can I tell you, favor ain't fair. All right? Favor ain't fair. But it's fabulous if you have it. Amen? All right? You ever met somebody with favor? Listen, in this point right here, I'm going to show you how to be that person. Hey, and I know that some of y'all got favor already. But wouldn't you like to bump up your favor? All right? All right? We're going to show you how to do it in this point. The Bible said great grace. It wasn't just grace that was upon them. Because some of y'all just operating in grace. But I'm about to show you how to tap into great grace. Amazing grace. Supernatural. Miraculous. If you don't want it, just tell me. I'm going to sit down. If you don't. Bible say great grace. And great grace was upon them. Oh God. For a whole church with great grace. Because some of y'all could see it on the leaders, the ministers and deacons, and some of you 12 leaders, you know that they're operating in grace. Some of y'all see it on First Lady and others and stuff like that, and you're like, oh, I'm happy for them, and you're not a hater, and you're just happy somebody around you got great grace. All right? And that's awesome that you're not a hater. All right? But can I tell you that God just don't want great grace upon your leaders? God want great grace upon us all. He said, great grace. Come on, Miss Bridget. Great grace was upon them all, every single one of them, Brother Carl. I'm talking about from the oldest to the youngest. Great grace was upon them all. Yeah. Would it be awesome, Lord, for a whole church that operates with great grace? Now remember, power comes from prayer. Much prayer equals much power, all right? Now let me show you where grace comes from. Now, B, remember, grace is unmerited favor. I won't cut it right for you. Meaning that you can't do anything to deserve it. You can't make it come upon you. But can I tell you, you can get in position for it? All right? I can't make the waterfall fall on you. But I can show you where to stand when the water starts flowing. All right? I can't make the quarterback throw you the ball. But I could teach you how to run around. I could show you how to get open. I can show you how to be jumping on the sidelines with nobody down there. And if quarterback Jesus wanted to score a touchdown with anybody, amen, he gonna look for the open man. Oh, Shalanda feeling me here. I'm speaking her language, all right? I'm about to show you how to get your Odell Beckham on, get your Dez Bryant on, get your Brandon Cooks on, all right? You know? Somebody say, Lord, I'm open.
Lord, I'm open.
Throw me some grace. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Woo! Much prayer equals much power. But let me show you where grace comes from. Grace comes from generosity. That's where it comes from. You get yourself in a position of grace by your generosity. Much prayer equals much power, but much giving equals much. Y'all must have got. You see, there's certain things that you can do to get yourself in a position of blessing. Certain keys that's going to unlock doors for you. Giving is one of them. Worship is another. Prayer is another. Some of y'all just got one door open. Some of y'all just got a crack in that one dough. Wouldn't you like God to open up all the doors in your life? All right? Where you're doing what you have to do in every area. So that whatever season he blessing, whether he blessing those that pray, blessing those that give, or blessing those that worship, no matter what season you in, you're going to thrive in every season. Because you done made yourself open in every situation. Much prayer equals much power. But much giving and much generosity equals much grace. Listen, if you look at Acts 3 and 32, the Bible corroborates this. Let's see. All right. I might have wrote down the wrong scripture. 2 and 32. Here it is. Acts 2. Check out verse 44. Don't worry about it. I know my Bible, even though my computer act up. Listen, Acts 2:44. And listen, look at this. And all that believed were together and had all things in common. 45, sold their possessions and goods, parted them to all men as every man had need. That's generosity. Now I told you where generosity is, favor gonna kick in, right? Didn't I tell you that? That there's a connection between generosity and favor. Now look down to 47. Right after they generous with one another, what happened? They were praising God and having what? Having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church. There is a connection, inextricable connection. Between generosity and favor. Listen, there's some of you here saying, I never get the breaks. I never get the blessings. I don't get the job. It seems like everything is against me. I guarantee you that we can make a connection to how generous you are with God to how generous God is with you. Woo-hoo! All right. Let me show you in another text, 2 Corinthians 9 and 6. Amen. I'm going to show that to you. Amen. 2 Corinthians 9 and 6. All right. This is the secret to grace. Amen. I'm going to show it to you in all kind of different ways. 2 Corinthians 9, 6 says this. But I say unto thee, Paul says, he which soweth sparingly, shall reap also sparingly, you see? And that's easy, all right? If you plant a few seeds, you're going to have a small crop. You sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. But if you plant a large number of seeds, look what it says, and he that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Listen, if we got a dude in here, with a little bag of sunflower seeds. And he go on 4 acres and he sow that little bag of sunflower seeds. 25 cent bag. But we got some pull up with a truckload full of seeds. Would we be surprised if the one with the truckload had a harvest of 25 acres? And the one with the bag of sunflower seeds had a few stalks. Would we be surprised at that? No. No. Then why are we surprised at that when it comes to giving in church? Woo-hoo! All right, look what he says. Verse 7, every man according as he purposes in his heart, because God is really concerned about when you give, not only the action of you giving, but your heart behind giving. Because we have some people give, but they don't give with the right heart. All right? You can't give to God with the wrong heart. Because God is not only concerned with our actions, he's concerned with the motives of our actions. All right? Every man according as he purposes in his heart. So you got to settle in your heart. What you're going to give, how you're going to give it, and you got to be all right with that. Can't be no grudgingly giver. And I'm going to show you in a second, amen, how, the tricks people do when they give. And that way they don't get the grace of giving. I'm going to show you that in a second. You see? He said, have your purpose in your heart, let him give. Not grudgingly or of necessity. Don't feel like you got to do it like it's a drudgery. You should want to do it. Because he got you alive today. He have you alive. You're healthy. You're saved. He died on the cross for you. For God loveth a what? A cheerful giver. But look at verse 8. After you give, what's going to happen? Let's look at the connection. Because some people think I'm up here just making stuff up. After you give, look what God says he's going to do. And God is able to make what? Oh. Do you see the connection? Much given, much grace. When you're generous, God makes not just grace and favor. He says all grace. People just think when you give to God in his house money, that you're going to get money, just money back. But God is wonderful when it comes to you giving to his house. When you give to his house, it's one of the only seeds that when you plant it, it not only grow the kind, but God's going to break his own law. Hey, God. And make that money that you give grow not only money and not only favor in a monetary sense, but he says, I'm going to make all grace, all kind of favor. Not just promotions, jobs, but health and healing and favor. Listen, your hair going to start growing long. Split ends going to stop. I ain't never had waves till I start tithing. Listen. And see, when I bless the Lord more, I get another one. Big brother is the answer. I'm telling you it's the answer, big brother. You come here next week with Afro, boy, you mess around. Listen. That's what happened to Dunny. Listen. He's able to make all grace. All grace. Anybody ever needed all grace? Favor in every area. Every area. When you walk in, prophet, they say favor just walked in. In every area. He's able to make all grace. All grace. Not only all grace, but he says he's able to make, when you are generous, all grace, what, Miss Amisha? Abound. What does that mean to abound? Abound means to overflow. To have more than what you need. It's the French word lagniappe. It's extra. You see, I just want grace, but God said, I'm not just going to give you all grace. I'm going to give you all grace abounding. You're going to have grace in every area, but in every area, you're going to have more grace than what you need. All grace abound toward you. That you always, that meaning every time of your life, if you're generous, always, that's a word of time. In every single moment of your life, always having all sufficiency, meaning that you will always have enough and always have what you need. All grace, overflow, always, all sufficiency in all things. This is the Bible now. In all things, so that you may abound to every good work. Anything you want to put your hands to, that grace is going to be upon that. Listen to me. Listen to me, Philly. This is the key to favor him. This is the key to favor. And while favor leaving the rest of the church, because they're only giving $20 a person on average. I'm giving you the secret that when favor leaving the rest of Christendom, us Hebrews can get an overflow of favor upon us in our churches. All right? All right? Because they leaving the word. They leaving the tithe. They leaving giving. All right? Because the season, the time of the Gentiles is over. The glory is gone. But as the glory is gone and that time is ending, our time is beginning. And we're going to get back, amen, to what they leaving off. We're going to get back to what we always did. All right? And favor is going to roll upon us like a mighty waterfall. Amen. Great grace comes from great generosity. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. All right. Point number two, possessors of land. I'm not making this stuff up. I'm not making this stuff up. Did y'all see the connection between giving and grace? All right. All right. All right. And I can show you some other examples. Yeah. Let's talk about it. Cornelius, the centurion. Oh, Brother Doug saw it. He was a giver. He was a giver. And Cornelius, because of his giving, was so big, the Bible says his alms came up for a memorial before God. Sabrina, you know your Bible. And what did God do for Cornelius because of his giving? He gave Peter a vision in a whole nother city and told Peter, get ready, some men coming for you. Go deliver the gospel of grace to Cornelius. Out of all the people on the planet at that time, God spoke to Peter to go to Cornelius and give him the message of the gospel, salvation by faith through grace, all because Cornelius was a giver. Much giving equals much grace. The best grace came to Cornelius, because Cornelius was a giver. The grace that teaches all men that we are sinners, that we are on our way to hell, but God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him, freely believe in him, shall not perish but have everlasting life, and receive a grace to forgive their sins and get them into heaven. I'm trying my best to show you. Now, it wasn't Cornelius' giving that got him into heaven, though. Cornelius' giving got him exposed to the message of grace. Now, he had to put his faith in it, but the giving got him in the door. How many people want to get in the door through giving, huh? Woo! That giving will get you in the right place at the right time. It'll give you favor. It'll give you favor. All right, second point. I just had to make a stronger connection for you. Possessors of land. The Bible says in Acts 4 and 34, neither was there any among them that lacked. Amen, I love this. Because if everybody give us, ain't nobody going to lack. And they taking care of one another. That's the second reason they didn't lack. For as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold. I have in my notes here, look at the benevolence, the love, and the giving of the early church. What they did, y'all, they liquidated extra assets to make sure the church had enough. What happened was is that some of them owned land and houses besides their primary domicile. Y'all know what I'm talking about? You know, you got your house in Karen Crow, John, but you got some land someplace else. You see what I'm saying? You got acres in Kankton. You got, I'm prophesying on you, John. Come on now. You know what I'm saying? John like, wait, I ain't got that. No, I'm telling you that you gonna have it, John. Woo! You got apartment complexes here. You see what I'm saying? You see, these people, amen, the early church, had loved Christ love their church, love the message, love the work so much that they looked out on their portfolio and say, what do I have extra? What do I have extra? I got this apartment complex over here. Amen. And I'm going to show you Barnabas got some property in Cyprus. That's beachfront property. We're going to see next week. He got property on an island. Them houses in Cyprus right now selling, none of them selling for under $1 million. And there's nothing new under the sun. Hey, we're going to see what Barnabas do with that property, beachfront property. They liquidated extra assets to make sure that the house of God, the message of Christ, the gospel, the souls of men would continue to be saved and that everybody in the church would have what they needed. That's amazing to me. Some of y'all listening like, man, I ain't that saved yet. But we're going to get you that saved. Amen? All right? Listen to me. They sold land and houses. Anything that was extra, anything that was sitting around collecting dust, anything that they wasn't using, they say, nah, I know who could use these proceeds. We just not going to have stuff sitting up doing nothing. When we can sell that stuff and bring the proceeds, amen, so that the church can continue to be on the move, so that the people of God could take care of one another. How in the world are you going to have a car that you don't use? Still run. Sitting up collecting dust. Worth about $3,000 or $4,000 while you got people in here that can't put on their light. People in here can't eat. Or are we trying to do a campaign and we looking for enough money to pay for the stage or the lighting? Amen. Here you got a car you're not using. But when you can take that thing and give through generosity, hey, the mission go on and you receive great grace. Anybody up in here? Oh, man, I'm preaching. I'm preaching to myself, eh? The early church liquidated some things. Listen, what I see is that they were not caught up on themselves. You see, living in America, we done got caught up on ourselves. How big a barns we can build. How much more we could have. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with being blessed and being wealthy. But even in that, it still can't be me, mine, my. You sound like Johnny Gill. My. That's your favorite song. That's what you're saying. But what about the house of God? What about the work of God? And what about the people of God? Here we are like the man building bigger barns while the church of the Most High God lay in dereliction and in poverty. There's nothing wrong with having no y'all. And believe me, I want to see every single person blessed. But like he told us in the scriptures, I believe it might have been in the book of Hosea. He said, how in the world y'all going to be blessed like that? And y'all going to be living like living? While my house lay in ruins. Anybody hear me up in here? All right. Listen, at Philly, we can't even talk about this level of giving yet. And that's why y'all kind of like, ooh. They so what? How? We can't talk about this level of giving yet. Because at Philly, most people not even tithing yet. All right. You can't get this level of giving where you began to liquidate extra stuff unless you're giving that bare minimum. And that's the tithe. You see? So I got in the prayer closet again and I said, Lord, what you want me to tell Philadelphia? We got 200 that's tithing. We got 1,000 that's not. What you want me to tell them, Lord? Lord told me this. And I'm going to put it up on the screen again. Remember, he told us first. He says, listen, if you don't bring me the tithe, you're going to always remain broke. Remember I told you that? They will always be broke until they give me the tithe. Write that down and bank on it. and bank on it. Because that's what the Bible said. That ain't no pastor telling you that. No, that's what the Bible said. We got people in here complaining about money this week, but don't see a correlation. They will always be broke until they give me the tithe. Now, I just want to see up in here. All right, we're going to do two questions. How many people want to be broke forever? Let me see a show of hands. All right. How many people don't want to always be broke? How many people don't want to be broke? How many people don't want to be fussing about how to pay a bill? What else I got to do? You want me to write the check for you? Take your checkbook and write it for you? Well, what else do I have to do? So I asked the Lord this time again. I said, Lord, it's another week. What do you want me to tell him? Look what he told me in the prayer closet. He told me, tell him this. Immature Christians don't tithe. You see, babies don't give nothing. If you're a baby, babies just, yeah, me. And we got about 1,000 of them up in here. You see? But grown-ups give. All right? Grown-ups tithe. Amen? A lack of tithing shows where you are in your spiritual journey. It shows that you still care too much about money. Because what's in between you and obeying God is a little piece of paper. Look at this little thing that the Ashkenazis print. That the Ashkenazis print, the Federal Reserve. We're going to give you the Hebrew nugget and show you that in a few weeks. This is what's in between you and obeying God. This. Look at it. Come on. Look at it. Don't you know no man can serve two masters? And all I do is show who really your master. That's all the tithe show. Because God say, give it. That money say, keep it. Give it. Keep it. Give it. Keep it. And so at that moment, we don't see who your God is, who you listen to. You see? Now you go put in that money and say, no, don't do it, keep it. You see, brother, come see, man. Yeah, that's what money made to do. That's the money made of it. Go ahead. Put that in your pocket, man. It have no value to just immature Christians. You know why immature Christians don't give? I'm going to tell you a couple of reasons. Listen. This is going to sound crazy. All right? Number one, it could be a sign that you don't know him. You're not even saved. Isn't that deep? I'm telling you, because you can only serve one master. But you're listening to the money. It could be a sign that God is not really your master. All right? I'm telling you, man. Unsaved folk don't tithe. And if they do, it's because they've grabbed the principles, amen, and they know they're going to get back. But most of them, because their master money won't let them. That's number one. Not tithing is a sign of not a real salvation. Listen, man. When you get a revelation of what Jesus did for you, My brother know what I'm talking about. When he gave his life, his blood, he suffered in pain. I was going to hell, man. You remember how we used to live? For him to change me like he did and bless me like he does. $20? If you see what I'm saying, Brandon, Miss Fulgence? If you can't give that, you don't have a real revelation of what the cross is. How can somebody give you something that's worth billions and then ask you for $50 and you say, no. That means you don't know what was just given to you. All right? You don't have a revelation of the cross. That's the first reason people don't tithe. Secondly, all right? You could be saved and not tithing. I'm going to give you that. Some people, all right? And because of media and because of TV and because of all the family and friends out there, don't give them people nothing. You know, like you giving to some people. You obeying God when you're tired. You're not giving to some people. His representative might get it, but we, hallelujah, have, hallelujah, a mandate to fulfill his work. Get it. You see what I'm saying? You see? But some people don't tithe, y'all, because they immature. It's not just that they're not saved. They immature and they don't love Christ like they think they love Christ. You don't love him. That's why you're not tithing. You don't love him. Or you love your money more than you love him. You see, because when you love somebody, you're going to give to them. All right? A man madly in love with a woman, you see? When that woman come ask for something, that man don't even want to give it. That money says, no! But I love her. No! All right? Now, some of the wives saying he used to do that. Because during the courtship, when we all madly in love, it don't matter. You buy anything she wants. The goal is to keep that going into the marriage. You could tell when somebody loves something because they give towards it. You can't love without giving, though. You can give without loving, but you can't love without giving. Love mandates a giving. For God so loved the world that he gave. You can't love without giving. That's how you could tell when a stepdaddy or stepmama don't really love the stepchildren. All right? Because they watching everything, them children not for them. Watching everything they eat. Where you got that bag of chips from? That's your second bag of chips in a month. That's too many chips. Your light on in your room. Turn that light off. I'm doing my homework. You could do your homework. Here, a flashlight. That's what they do to kids nowadays. And when Christmas roll around, they ain't getting too much. What you bought me, Daddy? Well, that gum was on sale at Walmart. And but let me see the flip now. Because a lot of times in them blended families, you not only got kids that's not for them, but you got dead kids as well. Now, you could watch the way they give to kids that's not their own. But in the very same house, watch how they take care of their own kids. Ain't nothing about how much they eat and how much light they. It's an issue of love. It's an issue of love. It's an issue of love. That's why I tie with blended families. Amen. Your father or your mother, and you got step in there. You gotta overcompensate for the natural lack of love that we have, because we gonna take care of our own better than the other one. It's natural. We sinners. We fallen. So because of that, hallelujah, we gotta overcompensate. You gotta artificially love them more than your own. And when you artificially overcompensate and love them more than your own, that's when it's going to be equal. You know what I'm talking about, big brother. You see what I'm saying? How we got on that? Love. When you love something or somebody, you give. People not giving a tithe because they don't love Christ like they think they love him. You know what the Lord say about us loving him? He say, you want to show me that you love me? He say, obey me. If you love me, obey my commandments. Because don't come around here and talk about you love God and you ain't doing what God say. He say, these people draw near to me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Be the first one in church shaking and dancing and praising. But when the offering come, they looking around, you know what I mean, checking their phone like it don't apply to them or something. I used to watch when people would come during praise and worship when we did the offering during that. It'd just be the 200. Most everybody's still in their seats. First one praising the biggest and the loudest. You don't love him like you think you love him. You don't love him like you think you love him. You're immature. You're a baby. Listen to me. I want to apologize to our tithers right now. I want to apologize to you. All right? Because we have found that the people who don't tithe want the most time, give the most trouble, talk about the ministry, gossip about me, worried about what I got on. They ain't giving anyway. What in the world you worry about what I drive and you ain't giving nothing? You ain't giving nothing. That ain't your... Listen. To the tithers, from my deepest heart, I'm sorry. Because a lot of the times we spending all our time, me and my wife, on people that's not all in, not committed. It's not an issue of who giving the most. The numbers is not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the commitment. You understand what I'm saying? Oh, man. I just want to apologize to you. Here's something else I'm going to do. All right? I'm going to say that. I said that already. A shaking is coming. Did I tell y'all that? I told you to put on your seatbelt. But I ain't told you this one. Positions are about to become available. Now listen, don't clap until you hear what I'm talking about. Because some of y'all clapping, y'all gonna be mad. Listen to this. From now on, since the tithe reveals so much about our maturity, so much about how we love God, and how we love the church that we're a part of. You see, because people that don't love Philly, they hear you, but they don't want to be here. They don't tithe. That really don't like me or my wife, offended because of the things that I talk about, they don't tithe. But that be the first ones, y'all, that when a position come up in the church to preach, to teach, to be a minister, a deacon, to be a 12 leader, a ministry head, the first ones to apply, the first ones to get mad when they're not selected, but they're the ones that's immature and not all in. Don't really love Christ, don't really love the church, and may not even be saved. All right, y'all, come on, lock in with me. So, watch the rationale here, B. If the tithe reveals how much we love Christ, how much we love our church, and how mature we are, then why are we promoting people that's not tithe? All right, that was half claps, B. You saw that? That was about 500 camera one. That was about 350 claps. Because, B, listen, if we got 1,200 in here, 200 given, that means that we have leaders that's not given. Leaders not tithing. Now, listen to me. No one will be promoted in Philly from this moment on that's not a tithe. Before, and it's not, Randy, look, don't let them try to lie and say it's a money issue. No, it's a spiritual maturity issue. Because the way we are with unfaithful mammon, the way we handle mammon determines a lot about it. Because where your treasure is, you gave it to me, Sabrina. Where your treasure, that's where your heart. If you ain't giving your heart not in it, then why should you be a 12 leader? Why should you preach? Why should you teach? You're not mature enough to do that. Why should you be a deacon? Why should you be a ministry head? What you going to teach the people and you not even where you're supposed to be? What? Woo! And look, I want to say I'm sorry. I'm sorry to my tithers up in here. For the positions that you got overlooked for. Because they got people in position with you or over you, not as committed as you. And I'm going to be the first one to say this. Pastor made a mistake. But you got to know my heart. I didn't want to be a church caught up on what people gave. I didn't want to be moved by dollars. But there's a way to do it without being moved by dollars. It's not about how much they tithe. It's just that they tithe. All right? If you do it, we could. All right. I'll be the first one to apologize. All right? Now listen to me good. Those that's already in leadership already, I love Kendrick Moore, but that's my boy. Listen, those that's already in leadership, you have been grandfathered in. Yeah, grace. Amazing grace. We will not remove you. We're not going to remove you. All right? But know this. All right? To be a leader, you will tithe. And we're not going to remove you, all right? But I want to know, sitting down with me face to face, if you are leading people in this here church and we don't see you tithing, okay? We're going to draw a direct correlation to immaturity and a lack of commitment and a lack of love for Jesus. And you're going to sit with your pastor and your first lady. And you're going to tell us what's going on. And listen, it's out of love. Because if you're going through financial struggle, we got people in here. Minister Duck, we got people in here. G Money, Brother Ben Robinson, we got people that can help you manage your money to a place to get you to the place of tithing. It's not to bring you in to fuss at you. It's to bring you in to be able to help you manage. And people, look, I'm looking at people that done sat with my wife before, because she phenomenal with numbers. You know what I'm saying? And, oh, listen, you'd be surprised, a little tweak here. That's a phenomenal with numbers. You'd be surprised, Brian Noel. You'd be surprised, a little tweak here, a little cut extra fat over here, a little this you don't need, a little that you don't need, and you'll be obedient to God, and more gonna start flowing in. You'll be surprised. You'll be surprised. And minister, we might need to get back. It might be a season of Dave Ramsey or some type of financial class again. You know, we might need a financial fitness here. You know, because listen, I believe in my heart that some of y'all don't want to disobey God. I believe in my heart of heart that some of y'all really love him. But you can't see the numbers. All right? If that's you, amen, they got people that can help you, man. All right? But I'm going to tell you, be that seeing the numbers thing. Because if you was the devil and you knew the power of tithe, would you ever let them see the numbers? Nah. It's never going to make sense. You don't think that the things that me and my wife give make sense on paper? It don't make sense. But at the end of the day, at the end of the week, at the end of the month, at the end of the year, I don't know where it come from, but it just all come together. He just, am I making sense? So listen. Leaders, you grandfathered in. But you know, it's going to be some communication between my people and your people. My office and your office. Mano to mano. And that's the cost of being a leader. All right? If you don't feel that the tithe is something that you should scripturally be doing, come sit with me. I'm going to show you from Abraham all the way to the New Testament how the tithe is New Testament scripture. All right? And then if I bring in the Hebrews of who we are, you know, you're going to tithe before the meeting over. And when I talk about your financial situation of not being blessed right now, you know, you're going to say that the Bible is true. All right? Let me see what else I got for you. All right, this is not about the amount. It's about the commitment. I just want to say that again because I don't want nobody coming here talking about, you know, nah. And listen, Todd, we're young, new Christians, and you don't, you know, you're young, you're new. You don't want to be in leadership, you know. I'm still got to get to the place where you mature, to the place where you're tithe. Amen. But this right here is really to focus in upon our leaders and those who want to lead in Philadelphia. Amen. All right. Let me see what else I got. I got to say that too, Lord? All right. Eventually, upfront ministries, amen, will go under scrutiny as well. Not just leaders, upfront ministries. How in the world are you going to be on the stage singing on the worship team and leading us in worship when you don't love God enough to give him his tithe? Because you up here singing, I put you first when it's a lie. When it's an absolute lie. You know what I'm saying? So eventually, I just want to get you ready to move into that. You see? I'm bothered also by our ushers. Our ushers who come up here and hold the tithes and offering basket in their hands, but not tithes. You see, I'm looking at it not from our perspective, but I'm looking at it from God's perspective. And God is looking from heaven and saying, why do you feel you should even put your hands on that basket? And you not a giver. Listen. Eventually, we're going to start with our leaders. We're going to move into worship team. We're going to move into ushers. Now listen, when people start leaving, don't come tell me with all of that. When they leave, you're going to know exactly why they're leaving, because they would rather keep their $50. They would rather keep their $50 than give it to the Lord. Don't come y'all with all that. Oh, Pastor, they leaving. Oh, we in trouble. We not in trouble. They don't want to serve no more. No, it's not that they don't want to serve. They don't want to tithe. Hole in the basket. God gave me a scripture. He showed me Achan. You know Achan, Miss Jen? In the book of Joshua, God told Israel, he said, go up and destroy Jericho. I'm going to make the walls fall down. But when you get in the city, don't you touch or take anything, because we will dedicate it all unto the Lord. That which we don't burn, you know, they're going to burn, kill everything. But the things that don't burn, they don't kill, they're going to bring it and dedicate it to the house of the Lord. It belongs to the Lord. Touch not belongs to the Lord. And he told them, don't touch the accursed thing. Somebody know they buy them. Because when you touch what belongs to him, a curse come on it. Don't touch the accursed thing. Achan went up in there. He said, I saw the wedge of gold, but it's the Lord's portion. I saw it and I coveted it. The wedge of gold and the Babylonian garments, that Gucci, that Versace they had up in there, I just couldn't stand it. So I took it, hid it in my tent, and buried it there. The people went out to do some great things again, fighting in the battle of Ai. They lost a battle to a people who were smaller in number. And Joshua looked up, he said, God, what in the world is going on? He said, they got sin in the camp, Joshua. They got sin in the camp. Standing there with that basket like that. Accursed hands. He said, they got sin in the camp. Figure out the one who touching not the accursed thing. Because that's why y'all don't have victory. They asked the Lord, how then shall we return unto thee, God? That's what Israel asked him. He said, will a man rob God? He said, you curse with a curse, even this whole nation. You could sit under who you want. You could follow who you want. You can go out, be in them Christian Gentile churches if you want. But as for us here, we're going to do things the Bible way. We're going to do things the Hebrew way. And look. you could sing, oh, I put you first. You could fake Jake if you want. We will refuse to be a fake church, and we're not going to have fake leaders. And we're not going to promote people that's not committed over people committed. We're not going to do that no more. We're not going to do that no more. We're not going to do it. It's not right. It's not right. Do you see Achan standing there with the basket? Do you see him? You see him working the cameras that your tithe bought that they never put no money into? You see him greeting people to a church, amen? Welcome to my, this not your church. You ain't putting nothing into it. You have no partnership with, how you going to welcome somebody to a place you have no investment in? How you going to do that? I know what it is. It's free. the Negro still stuck on free. He's still stuck on free. He want all the benefits with no investment. No investment. Let me tell you something, man. Oh, God. Should I say it? Listen, that same government assistance, that same food stamp welfare, listen to me now, listen to me good now, that same thing you praising government for has become a crutch unto our people. That's how we walking right here. Can't do nothing on our own. We waiting for Mr. Charlie to give us something. We can't do nothing. Come on, man. Yes, sir, Mr. Charlie. Yes, sir. When he trying to take us to the promised land, get rid of the crutch. Have our own land flowing with milk and honey. Our own businesses. Our own income. You waiting on Mr. Charlie to hand you a melon and a leek. That what you waiting on? Instead of eating filet mignon, you want a melon. I'm not talking about our brothers and sisters who really need it. Those that's disabled or those that's of that age. But what I am talking about is them full-figured fine Hebrews with healthy bodies and healthy minds. Faking, talking about they disabled. You want a handout, man. You want a handout, man. Is the problem with our people? But we're going to solve it in here. All right? All right? You might not understand, but this tithe is so good for you. It's going to get your heart committed. You can't stop talking about us and you hate us, amen, but you start tithing. It's easy for somebody to come and divide you and take you away from the church and start some beef with you, amen. Hallelujah. You know why it's easy? Because you're not tithing. Oh, God, oh, God. We have found out that the people prone to division when they're trying to get out of Philadelphia, the people that's not tithing more prone to it. It's amazing. They talk about us less. They work the hardest. Give the less trouble. Need the least babying and tatan. And give the most. And when they try to divide them, they're not going nowhere. Man, that's where my heart at, man. I'm invested. I don't visit. I don't come here. I'm a partner in this thing. Philly didn't throw a campaign. We threw a campaign. My tithe went to pay for lights and camp. Am I tripping, y'all? Okay, okay. I just won't check. Let me pass to you. It's going to do a world of good for your maturity as a Christian and as a man and as a woman. You pay your way. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. All right. Point number three, at the apostles' feet. All right. Let's look at this now. Let's look at this. All right? The Bible says that they sold the extra. And look what they did with the proceeds. And laid them down. Where? At the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. Listen, they brought the tithes. They brought offerings, they brought the proceeds, and they laid it at the apostles' feet, at the leaders' feet. All right? This means a few different things. It means, number one, they didn't come and say, "Pastor, I don't believe in a tithe. But if y'all need something, just tell me and I'm going to buy it." Because that's how some people do me. Like, "Pastor, if y'all need something, I'm going to tell you what I need. I need you to tithe. That's what I need. If you need something, if I need something, do what the Lord told you to do, man. That's what I need. Pastor, if you need something." All right? They laid it at the apostles' feet. This means they didn't sell chicken dinners. They didn't wash cars. This is the house of God. This is not 4-H, y'all. This is not an AU basketball team. We going to stand out? Pastor, I know we're going to stand out on Willow. This is the house of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Sell a chicken dinner to do what? Why would God need to sell a chicken dinner? Why would a king need to wash some cars? You know why a king don't sell a chicken dinner? Why a king don't wash a car? Because a king got a people, and a people take care of their king. Anyone? Do you understand how royalty would work? The king would provide a city for his people to live in, provide protection and different things that they could not provide for themselves. And in lieu of that provision from their king, we've been living in a democracy too long. In lieu of that provision from their king, the people would give a portion to their king. And it kept the kingdom going. God don't need to wash no cars. God don't need to sell cars. We're not selling them little candies for $1 and $2. We're not doing that. Don't come here with all your ideas about how we finish this building. And don't you dare call me about why the building not finished. You want to know why the building not finished? Because only 200 people tithing and 1,000 of y'all not. Don't call me. Don't ask me that. Don't ask me that. Don't ask me that. Don't ask my wife that. The building would be finished tomorrow. Now, you know it can't be tomorrow, but I'm saying. We'd have people working over here like ants if y'all did what y'all. Pastor, I know we're going to sell. We're going to make. Pastor, we're going to have a big garage sale. The church don't have garage sales. You see, people do that to skate tithing. When they come and tell me that, look how I look at them. I don't say nothing, but I just want to know that I see you, dog. I see you. You just don't want to tithe. The church, they didn't bring their stuff and have a garage sale. They sold their stuff and brought the tithe and the offering, and they laid it. We just going through the scriptures, yeah, y'all. That's all we doing. All right? They laid it at the apostles' feet. You see? Here it is. All right? Now, laid it at the apostles' feet also means a trust. They didn't tell the apostles what to do with it. Because some of y'all give and y'all want to tell everybody what to do with it. You're getting $20 and you say, "Pastor, that's going to go to, that's going to." Did they say where it was going to go right here? Did they say it in the scriptures? What they did. You know why? Well, you see, we've been living in the Goyim system too long. We don't know the Bible. You never pick a pastor or a leader that you can't trust with money.
if you gotta govern, that's go to that and that. If you can't trust giving to your pastor, you in the wrong church. The requirement for a pastor, you see, is that we be not covetous or greedy for filthy lucre, as the King James would say. And if you can't trust your pastor with your tithe, then you gotta, some people say, well, I'm not going to tithe. No. You got to go to a place, find your place where you can trust the pastor with the tithe. All right? And really and truly, let me say this. Really and truly, look. You make sure you're sitting under a good pastor that's fulfilling the requirements issued out by the Pauline epistles in Titus and also Timothy. Amen? All the characteristics. You sit under that, you lay that at the apostles' feet, you tie, and what you do is you release that. You release that. Some of y'all give, but in the spirit, you're still holding on to it. You put the check in the basket, but you got a string, spiritual string, that come all the way back to your hand. It's way in your hand, wrapped around your fist. And so you give and you watch. Oh, he got new socks on today. You ain't gave. They laid it. It was a release. See, when you release it, all right, when you release it, you trust that they're going to do what they got to do with it. All right? We got too many people worried about somebody else's role, position, job, while they neglect to do their own. All right? In football, the quarterback is complaining about the wide receiver. And the wide receiver complaining about the quarterback. And the coach is like, would y'all both just do your job? Can you run the route? That's why you're not the quarterback. So we got tired of worrying about pastors. No. Just do your job, man. Do your part. And if you can't trust it, leave. All right? Now, by way of whether you can trust Philadelphia or not, look at our track record. With 200 tithers, we have three facilities. This facility, Pine Street, and we got PCM, our college campus university. All right? We got a school. We paid 13 teachers. Did I say 13 teachers? Five teacher aides we pay. We have 190 students. We have a college ministry, a radio ministry, a TV ministry, internet, Facebook. We do campaigns out in the community. We give away cars. We do grocery drops. The church offer 200 people, pay me, pay my wife. Now, we don't get paid what we support, because she is a principal of a school of 190. Pay me, pay my wife. We got a staff over here. We pay two ministers, a deacon, Ms. Michelle, and Ms. Shalanda. All that, what I just said, offer 200 tithes. It reminds me of a story. And our worship leader. We pay our worship leader. Thank you, baby. That's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. Yeah. Look. Listen now. Offer 200 tithes. You don't trust your pastor. You see, the pastors you don't trust are like this. Boy, we talking today. Yeah. Boy, y'all into y'all pastor heart today. Yeah. I think I'm revealing too much, Doug. The pastors you don't trust are the ones that you tithe, but you don't see no return. It's like the businesses that you go eat that all the time? And they pack, but they never invest back in their business. The carpet messed up, the ceiling fall, and you're like, man, I'm spending $30 a week over here. And y'all can't put back into it? Now, who been in Philly for over 2 or 3 years? Anybody? Are we still in the same place where we was? Do we have more than what we started with? Can you see where your money going? Where your tithe going? Are we still, amen, at MP Moss while I'm driving, like they say, a Bugatti? Huh? Is that what's going on? What you complaining for? What are you complaining for? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Look, you ain't been to a church that abused money before. You ain't been there before. Some of y'all ain't. Some of y'all have. But you ain't been there. If you think that we are, you ain't been there. Them young Christians, boy. Listen to me. Hallelujah. Do your part. They laid it at the apostles' feet. This also means don't come back for it. Big brother, I'm cutting up. Tree, I'm cutting up, my tree. Listen. I'm telling you. They got some that'll come back for it. And they treat us, you know, you know when you had somebody you could trust and you would tell them, hold my money? My wife liked that for a lot of people, you know what I'm saying? They give her money and they say, hold that, because they know she ain't going to spend it. She real frugal and stuff like that. So you know what I'm saying? They give the money to her and they say, hold that, you know? And because they think they going to spend it. You know what I'm saying? We got some people like that in here. All right? You know? And when they need it to pay that bill or whatever like that, they just go back to that person. Miss Chantel, you got that from? All right. Yeah, and they get it. And then they could pay their bill. We got some people treat church like that. They don't lay it at the apostles' feet. They don't really tithe. They come in and they say, Now I'm going to come back for it now. When my gas bill due, when my light bill due, I'm going to come back for it. They treat church like a bank, like a credit union, you see? And it's not really giving. It's not really tithing. It's holding. It's saving. It's a checking account. And then I mentioned free checking. We got some that do that. Listen, if you part of that group, you're not going to get the grace and you're not going to get the blessings. Because at the end of the year, amen, and listen, I remember I said in the beginning I wasn't going to be looking at tithing information. I will be looking at tithing information from now on. Because as your pastor, amen, I believe that it correlates with your spiritual development, amen. And while I may not look at actual numbers, amen, I want to see, amen, what's going on, amen, see your development. Because when we look at people that give and come back for it, a lot of the times what they give in the year and what they came to get, the come getting is more than what they gave. All right? So you ain't gave nothing. I remember me and my wife having a conversation. They had a particular person that would come all the time, and I just tell them, just give them back their tithe. Just give it back to him. They laid it there and left it there. You know? Did I say don't come back and get it? Okay, listen. Let's wind down, and I'm going to talk with you about some other things a little bit. What did the apostles do with the tithes and offerings? All right? Here we go. Because we know the whole of Scripture, we can look at this text and we can use the principles of sola scriptura, amen, and we can see a pattern of what leaders are supposed to do with the monies, amen. All right? Obviously, amen, we know that when they laid it at the apostles' feet, the apostles took care of their personal needs, meaning that they took a salary for the ministry. You got to understand that the preacher of the gospel, the Bible says, should live off the gospel. All right? That's it. All right? That's it. You don't muzzle the ox that tread the corn. Amen? You don't allow somebody to come up and preach and teach everybody how to be blessed, and they don't be blessed themselves. You don't do that type of stuff. You see? So obviously, the apostles took what they needed. You know they took what they needed, a salary, because Jesus had told them to give up their careers. They had careers. They were fishermen and did pretty good at it. Had businesses, had boats. When you read about it, they had boats. It wasn't a one-generation business. Hallelujah, their daddies was out there most of the time. And when he said, come and follow me, they had to leave their profession. Oh, come on, somebody. They had to leave their profession. And when Peter denied the Lord, amen, the first thing he did when he was backsliding, he went back to fishing. And where did the Lord go get him from to bring him back? He went get him from that boat. And said, Peter, lovest thou me more than these? To the disciples, yeah. After it was laid to the feet, laid at their feet, they sure took care of their personal needs. You say, but Pastor Paul worked, but you don't read your whole Bible. Paul only worked because haters would talk about him. That's all the reason he did. Paul understood, he wrote that the minister of the gospel should live by the gospel. He understood that. He said, but because y'all immature and y'all such some haters, I got to build some tents. He said, I got the authority, but y'all not letting me use it. But I believe as a church, we beyond that. What did they do with the monies? Obviously, they took care of their personal needs. Obviously, they took care of the needs of the ministry. Amen. And then after that, the Bible says in the next verse, and they... Hallelujah. And distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. The disciples, after taking care of personal needs, after taking care of the needs of the ministry, they made distribution. Distribution. Distribution to the poor. Those who didn't have. Matthew Henry says that the disciples gave funds to those who couldn't work and secure proper maintenance for themselves. People that couldn't work, couldn't make money because of age, because of sickness, because of disability, because of an incapacity of mind. They provided for those who was weak among them. That's when you got a church that's tithing. You see, back then they didn't have no Social Security. They didn't have no Medicare, Medicaid. They didn't have food stamp. And the day may be coming soon where we're living in a country where we don't have that anymore. Eve, as a church, we got to get ready for that. But you can't get ready with a people that's not tithing. So they made distribution. But listen good now. Distribution according as he had need. Pastor, what's a need? A need is a necessity. Something that you need for survival. something that you need to keep living, to go on. That's a need. We got people coming to church and asking for things that's not needs. Your cell phone bill is not a need. Hey! Come on now. That's not a need, friend. Your car insurance is not a need. You don't need that for survival. Not when they got the city bus. No. Not while they got bicycles and Pete and Paul. You're going to survive without car insurance, and you're going to survive without a car. A car is not a need. It's a luxury. You can get where you're going faster, but can't you still get where you're going? Oh, I'm getting a few amens, a few amens. Well, Pastor, well, you know, I always thought it was a need. What's a need, Pastor? Food, water, clothing, shelter. And within shelter would be light, gas. You know what I'm saying? Things to keep you warm within your home. Cable ain't no need. Pastor, my Cox bill due. Good. It's time to turn it off. Maybe you're going to start tithing. All right? Yeah. What's the need? All right? Got people coming in asking us to pay their tickets. That's not a need. Pastor, pay my child support. So what? And a need can't be because of mismanagement of funds. So, all right. You didn't buy your family no food. They turn your water off. They turn your lights off. You don't have no shelter. But you done went to bingo all week. You was at the casino. You was dancing hard in the club. While U.S. was turning the lights off at your home. You've been buying alcohol, but you ain't got no bread and no meat, no lunch meat at the house. You're buying drugs. You got a shopping problem. You come your dress to the nine, nails done, hair looking nice, clothes come out the cleaner, but you come here, pay my light bill. I go ask the cleaners to pay your light bill. You see, more money is not going to help the problem. When you give to people who mismanaging funds, more money is not going to help the problem. More money is just going to exacerbate the problem. That's all it is. And they're going to look at you as though, amen, you were the rich uncle. They're going to live in an unfrugal, mismanagement, balling way. Taking care of all they wants and not taking care of their needs because they know they got somebody that's going to take care of their needs. And you're not helping a person like that. You're hurting a person like that. So the church going to say no. If it's mismanagement, the church going to say no. If you ain't got no light but your cable's still on, I don't know how you watch TV in the dark, we going to say no. All right? Listen to me. It's got to be a need. What's a need, Pastor? Well, you can't have nobody else to help you. A legitimate need. And look, I was wrong about this. All right? I used to tell people, man, listen, go ahead, come. Don't worry about asking your family, go ahead, come. I was wrong about that. As we look at our Bible closely, that's not the way it works. The church is the last place you come, not the first. All right? Watch me now. Follow me. We see the principle when the Bible talks about taking care of widows. He said, take care of widows that are widows indeed. And he tells us, amen, if she got family that can take care of her, don't take care of her. Because a man that don't take care of his own household is worse than an infidel. If she got another way to take care of her needs, you don't take care of her. A legitimate need is when you don't have nobody else to do it. We got some people come to church first. The wife ain't even asked her husband, she gonna come to church. The child not gonna ask the parent. You see? The parent not gonna ask the child. You don't come to church first, you come to church last. And you know why you come to church last? Because every dollar you take from church is a dollar less that we could put into saving the souls of men. Oh, man, you ain't got it yet, though. It's less flyers, less radio, less TV, less gospel. You see? So you don't come first. Here's the last thing. Saints of God, you need to get yourself in a position where you can take care of yourself and your family. Men, I'm talking to you up in here. All right? And ladies, too. If your man can't do it by himself, you go get you a job. You try to help him. You be a virtuous woman. Don't sit on your butt lazy at home. Did I say that? Yeah, I said that. Don't sit there on your tail lazy at home while y'all struggling, man. Looking for a handout. The virtuous woman went out and did something. She added to her home. We're living in a time where because of economics and the American way, a lot of the times we need two incomes. Now, if your husband balling like that and you don't have to work, man, don't work, girl. But if y'all struggling and you got to borrow, you go to payday loan. You being a kid. Hebrews, get yourself in a position where you can take care of yourself. You can take care of your family. Don't you be sitting there waiting for the job you want when you can make some money at a job that you could do. You go get your job, man, and you work. The Bible says, let him that steal it no more, but go and work, laboring with his hands, that instead of stealing, he can have something to give. Get yourself in a position where you don't have to ask no more. You don't have to beg no more. We got some people with a problem where they don't ask for nothing. They won't ask. They'll be starving at home, won't ask. We don't want you there, but we don't want you on the other extreme. Well, you're asking all the time, and you're comfortable asking, and you don't feel nothing about your manhood, nothing about your family for being a parasite and for being a leech. If you don't feel nothing about that, you're on the opposite extreme. There is something wrong with you. If a man don't provide for his own home, he's worse than an infidel. Listen to me. My people, listen, get yourself in a position to take care of yourself, to take care of your children. Work as unto the Lord. We go through seasons. All of us go through seasons of lack. We get laid off. Providentially, something happens, and we don't have it like we used to have it. But that's seasons. And seasons change. I'm talking about the person who live in Antarctica. You live in lack. You just stay there. There's no season. You're always without. you always need. When people see you coming, they know already what it's about. A legitimate giver don't have no problem with people that go through seasons. You know the ones that stay there. Get yourself in a position. Get yourself in a position. You know that government assistance was always supposed to be temporary? Public housing? Projects? Supposed to be temporary. Why we got people living in the projects forever? Why mama was at there, and then the daughter there, and then the granddaughter there? What? It was supposed to be temporary. Don't you know, like welfare and food stamps, it's supposed to be temporary. Listen, don't get mad at me, no. Yeah, you see, listen, white people wish they could tell y'all that. Some of our European brothers and sisters in here, tell them. Oh, God, I love this church. Listen. White people wish they could tell y'all. Because y'all sitting on them government programs forever. What that's going to teach your son and your daughter? Get up, man. Get up, man. Get up, man. Get up. It's supposed to be just for a season. See? Just for a season. Look, we done talked about a lot. I done offended many. All right? Let not many desire to be teachers, because they offend a lot. Now, I understand that. We talked about, amen, the great grace that could be upon you if you just be a giver. We talked about, amen, the Bible, how it says, amen. What was our second point, John? Come on, Sound Boot, help me out. What was our second point? Possessors of land, how they liquidated. So we talked about the tithe in that, the basic minimum up in that. I also told you that leaders will be no leaders in here coming up. That's not tithers. I also told you that the leaders that's here, that's not tithers, we're going to be talking. All right? I understand some people going to withdraw. It's good. It's good. We look, when you leave, we're not really losing nothing. But the answer is not to leave. No. Because you're going to leave, go to another church, they're going to tell you the same thing. And you know what would burn me up? You're going to start tithing over there. Oh, boy. And lastly, we talked about laying it at the apostles' feet. Listen, we're going to do the tithe. Ushers, come on, get ready. Pastor, I don't want to hold a basket. I'm not a tither. I'm going to give you grace for this Sunday. All right? So go ahead, get your basket and come. And by next Sunday, you're going to be a real basket holder because you're going to be a tither. All right? It's new information. Y'all, come on to the altar, usher. Come on to the altar. 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 Phil, we just going to do music. And I like that picture, just tithes and offerings. We just going to do music. I'm not going to talk too much. Come on and give. Don't give to me. Give to the Lord. Come on and give. Come on and give. Don't give to me. Give to the Lord. Give to the Lord. Give to his house. Don't you be worrying about nothing. All right? We got some that give online. I understand that. So when you see some people, not because they're not tithed, some of them not tithed, but others, they give online. And I understand that. In fact, Brent, if you could put up the online site and the phone number. If you don't have cash, amen, you can give, amen, online. Here's our website. And we actually got a phone number that you can text. Brent, try to get that up for me. Amen. Here it is. Here it is. If you want to give through text. But the answer is give. The answer is give. You know? It's the last days. And we ain't going to play no more, y'all. The Hebrews going to have to be who we called to be. We got to return to him in every way. Is there anybody else before we go? Anybody else? Praise the Lord, my brother. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Anybody else? Y'all all right with me talking real with y'all? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, woman of God. Lord, bless you. Lord, bless you. Thank you, Lord. We're going to have a breakthrough. We're going to have a breakthrough. We're going to have a breakthrough. Ushers, we release y'all. Brothers, go with them. Amen. That go with them and handle business. Amen. Ushers, y'all can go now. Y'all can go. Amen. Now think about this now. Think about this. Amen. Just follow Duck. Just follow Duck and Minister Ann. Amen. Now think about this. Look all we doing on 200 people. Woo! All right. It's altar call time. Amen. It's okay. If you're here and say, Pastor, I'm not saved. I felt it during this whole sermon. And I want to be saved. You went through the gospel and you talked about grace. And I'm ready to receive that same grace Cornelius received. I'm ready to be saved. It's easy. You admit you're a sinner, believe in the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, and confess him as your Lord, and you shall be saved. There's some, you was alerted to your lack of salvation just by presenting to you, amen, giving and generosity. If you have any question about your eternal destination, amen, in a second you can come. If you're here and this message that's convicted you and you want God to get your heart right and get yourself in a position where you can be as generous as you know you could, amen, the altar is open. Everybody can come if you're ready to come. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. We're here. We're going to pray a little bit, then we're going to leave. We're here. We're here. Come on, pray with me. Come on, pray with me. Come on, pray with me. We're going to get out of here. Come on, pray with me. Amen. Come on, pray with me. Come on, pray with me. We got to get our people up. We got to get them out. We got to get them off. That bottle's about to be broken. Ain't going to be no milk in that bottle no more. Got to get off the noon. You got to get off the bottle, baby. Got to get yourself on some hard, some real food. Be able to support yourself. Digest your own food. See? Somebody say, Lord. Thank you. For being real. With me. I admit. I've sinned against you. And I'm sorry. But I believe. That Jesus Christ. Died on the cross. For all my sins. He was buried. And on the third day. He rose with all power and all might. Lord, save me. a sinner. Use me and change my heart and help me to love you more than I love money. Help me to love you more than I love myself. Make me a giver. Make me a tither. Make me generous like you were generous to me. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God some glory.